Hello. Today I'd like to talk about community co-benefits. And my goal with this video is to kind of illustrate what you should potentially be looking for if you're buying carbon credits and those carbon credits come with a bunch of community co-benefits. How do you actually determine whether or not community co-benefits are a net good, kind of okay, or actually kind of bad? So before we actually get into like the rubric of how I judge community co-benefits, I want to make four rather lecherous points regarding carbon philosophy. And the first point I feel like I have to make is that doing something about your pollution and protecting a forest in and of itself is very, very good. You know, if we think about all the different types of carbon credits out there, renewable energy credits, direct air capture, enhanced rock weathering, nature-based red plus carbon credits, it's kind of only the one that comes with an expectation of community co-benefits as well. So community co-benefits are good, obviously, but it's also okay just to protect a forest that's owned by some private landowner in order to do something about your pollution. Both options are really quite good. The second lecherous point that I want to make is that do community co-benefits even make sense? Let's think about this from a first principles point of view. The way that carbon credits are intended to work is that, you know, you were going to cut down a tree or you were going to use land to, you know, farm cattle or something, and someone's going to come along and pay you to not cut down that tree or pay you to stop using that land for cattle and let it rewild. Okay, so that's how it's supposed to work, right? Core to that concept is that the carbon credits or the money is supposed to compensate the farmer for the timber rights that they've now lost. So there really should just be a direct one-to-one compensation between I was going to make $5,000 off this timber, now I'm going to make $5,500 by not cutting the timber. Let's do that instead. But, you know, somewhere along the line, it kind of became okay to tell people, well, you can't harvest the trees and we're not going to pay you directly, but instead we're going to, you know, give you a beekeeping course and build you a community school. I want you to imagine from your point of view, if for the last 50 years your community had allowed you to farm some piece of land, this year they're telling you you're not allowed to anymore, and they're saying, oh, don't worry, you can take a beekeeping course. You would be very upset. So from a first principles point of view, oftentimes we kind of conflate equity in the carbon markets with community co-benefits. And this gets me to my next big point, which is that in some cases, community co-benefits are used as an excuse to avoid paying people. And this is where it gets really dangerous, right? Because you'll see these carbon project developers out there talking about how they built a school and a water treatment plant and, you know, paved the roads to the community. And this is all great. This is all great. But it cost them about $1.5 million to do that. And they've really made something like $30 million off the natural resources of the area. We have to remember that carbon credits are a form of natural resource extraction. And when we extract a natural resource from a developing community, the payments to that community need to be commensurate. Otherwise, we're talking about colonialism. So we really need to make sure that community co-benefits don't just tell a fluffy story, but they're actually returning the value of the timber that we're taking away from people. And that brings me to my last point, which is that the carbon needs to take precedence in all of these projects. Too many carbon projects have sacrificed their carbon numbers in order to, you know, allow for community co-benefits. And they often say something like, oh, this project is doing really great work to the community. Let's just kind of like rig the baseline of it so that the community gets more money. This is a really bad idea for a lot of different reasons, but let me just list out three of them real quick. The first is that pollution is still going into the atmosphere and everyone is still going to suffer from that, including your community. The second is that, you know, you are putting your entire carbon project at risk because someone like me or some reporter could come along and say, your carbon credits are nonsense, and just like that, the community stops receiving funding. What the heck is going to happen to Kariba now that South Pole has bailed on it? As far as I can tell, the people in that community are never going to get paid. And the last risk that actually takes place is from the buyer perspective. If you are just buying carbon credits based on the smiling faces of children that you're seeing in an image from a carbon project developer, you are at real risk of scandal. You need to look into the numbers and make sure that the carbon credits are legitimate before you even like purchase credits. Otherwise, the next time The Guardian or Bloomberg writes an article, it's going to be about your company. All right, we've gotten done with the lecture. Let's talk about how I actually value co-benefits. So I'm going to break it up. We break it up into basically three tiers. So the top tier of co-benefits are direct payments. And indeed, one can really ask whether or not there's any type of co-benefit out there except direct payments. And what I mean by direct payments is when individual names are listed out and receipts are provided on the internet of how much money each year those people earned. Now, a core concept to this is that this all needs to be made public in order for it to be, you know, verified and legitimate. All carbon projects should have public budgets. And this is a core carbon principle that is inexplicably missing from a lot of core carbon principles out there. Let us remember that these projects are taking place in the developing world where money can get lost. They're often being sponsored by these megalithic project developer companies that have a track record of taking all the money for themselves. And the idea that we're accepting of carbon credits that don't publicly describe where every dollar actually went to the ground is absurd. Shame on Vera for not requiring all carbon credit budgets be made public. So, how often do we really see direct payments being listed out to people? Well, not too often, especially not on Vera. But there are a number of carbon projects that do this. There's a handful of projects on Vera that do. And there's a bunch of carbon projects outside of Vera, you know, like registered in Gold Standard and whatnot, that do actually list exactly where every dollar is going and to who that dollar is going to. Here's the thing, though. I'm a pragmatist. I recognize many of these projects have tens of thousands of people living inside of them, and they come and they go, and you can't go and hand deliver checks to every single person. That's a very difficult thing to do. So another kind of top-tier co-benefit, which is good, but not quite as good as direct payments, is payments to community groups. So, you know, ideally, the way that this could work is that some democratically elected council is receiving payment for the carbon credits and distributing that to their community based on, you know, what's best for the community. And some of my favorite carbon projects do this. So, I mean, Delta Blue Carbon is an example that actually established councils made up of only women. Because let's be honest, women are much better at responsibly managing finances than men. And those female councils then were responsible for distributing the money to their communities. The key here is that extra diligence is needed to make sure that the money goes to the people on the ground and not just some local strongman. So you really need to be, once again, completely transparent with the budgets, and you need to make the council be transparent with the budgets to make sure that they actually spent the money on the, you know, the new water treatment plant instead of building themselves houses. You know, when extra diligence isn't done, this has led to some scandals in the industry. So, you know, we've had cases where, like, you know, like Zimbabwe millionaires are responsible for distributing the money and they just pocket most of it, and or they're driving around with wads of cash in a Jeep. And, you know, we've even had instances where the people on the ground responsible for distributing the money to the community are exchanging the money for sexual favors. You know, so if payments are going to be made through community councils or through community leaders, we have to do an extra level of diligence. And once again, everything needs to be completely public. The next tier down below direct payments are what we call tangibles. And what I mean usually by tangibles are like infrastructure investments. Now, we recognize it's not always easy to establish community councils. It's not always easy to directly pay every single person inside of a Red Plus project. So maybe another alternative to make sure the money gets to the ground is to invest that money directly into the community. This can include things like, you know, water treatment plants, healthcare, transportation systems, schools. These are all pretty good. However, my company only considers tangible infrastructure to be a community co-benefit if it really is tangible. We need the project developer to state with absolutely clear numbers exactly how much money it's going to take to build the school, exactly how many schools are going to be built, exactly how big the school is going to be, and exactly when they're going to do that in a reasonable timescale. And the reason that we need to do all this is that there's a number of kind of stinky projects out there that have, you know, promised to build schools, and more than 10 years later, the schools are not built. So we really need to keep the project to its committed timelines and make sure that its timelines are reasonable and make sure that everything has dollars and cents tied to it. But here's the thing about, you know, the tangibles, about infrastructure. We really need to make sure that the tangibles are commensurate with project income. It's easy to say we're going to build 6 one-room schools inside of a project and everyone feels really good about that. But maybe it only costs you $250,000 to build 6 schools out of cinder block, But in reality, the project has made something like $30 million. So as we get further and further down the you know, Elias's favorite types of community co-benefits, we have to keep in mind that it gets easier to obfuscate where the money is going. So here's a tip. If you are buying carbon credits from a project, simply add up all of the direct payments to individuals, the payments to community groups, and the payments for tangibles, and see whether or not that value is commensurate with the amount of money they're making off of carbon credits. Because you can add up how many carbon credits the project has made, and you can say, oh, they're selling for about $4.50 today. And then you basically have two numbers. You have a number that says how much they spent on community co-benefits or how much they intend to spend, and you have a number that says how much they're going to make from carbon credits. And ideally, you want those numbers to be within the same ballpark. Way too many projects out there, when you start adding up the numbers, are inexplicably making something like $30 million in carbon credits, but their listed community co-benefits are something like $1.5 million. This is a practice that Cecil Rhodes himself would be proud of, you know? We built him a railroad, what else do they need? We have to remember that natural resources, to the tune of $30 million in this case, are being extracted from a community, and something very commensurate with the value of those natural resources need to be returned to the community. Anything less than that is literally colonialism. And the problem is that you've got these projects that are going out there saying like, oh, we built 2 water treatment plants and we built 6 schools. And, you know, that does not come anywhere near the value of the credits that they removed from the community. When you're buying carbon credits, make sure that you do this simple add up. Okay, there's one more tier of community co-benefits that we haven't talked about here. And these are what we call the intangibles, AKA the junk benefits. So what are intangibles? These are the types of co-benefits that are talked about in project description documents that don't really have a dollar value associated with them. Maybe it's some sort of community get-together meeting where they're talking about job training. Maybe it's community beekeeping courses. Maybe it's community gardening courses. These are all ephemeral benefits. You know, they're going to get their course and then they're never going to get any benefit out of that again. And they're almost impossible to actually quantify as good or bad. And a lot of the time, they're classified as alternative job training. Now, I want you to think of the injustice of that. We are taking away someone's timber. We are telling them that they can no longer cut their trees down for timber. And we're telling them that they can no longer use that land for agriculture. And in place of that, we're saying, well, pull yourself up by your bootstraps and get a job. This is incredibly unjust. And so whenever we see job training as a community benefit that's listed, we throw it in the garbage. The other thing that Renostra does not consider to be a community co-benefit is job creation itself. Many of these projects, you know, claim that they're creating a bunch of jobs for the local communities. And they are. I mean, to be clear, sure they are. But rarely have we found that the jobs created by the project, you know, supersede the jobs that they would have earned from whatever they were doing otherwise. Usually it takes more jobs to manage cattle than it does to manage trees. And so whenever we see job training, we usually throw that one in the trash too. We don't consider that to be a legitimate community co-benefit. So all these kind of intangible things like job training and jobs themselves and beekeeping courses and, you know, courses on you know, whatever it may be, those are just ways to obfuscate not paying people their due. The last thing that I want to talk about real quick is securing land tenure. And we don't know what category to really put this into, because in some cases, securing land tenure for communities or for individuals can be really, really good. You know, after the 30 years of the project, they have like a solid piece of paper that you know, they're building equity and they can use to get like a small loan from a bank in the country. But in other cases, we've seen people claim to be getting land tenure that is not so good. So there's a project in Brazil that claimed that they were securing land tenure for a bunch of people inside the project, but they weren't. They were just putting on a list that eventually may lead to land tenure at some point. There's a project in Cambodia that claims that they're securing land tenure for communities, but really it was just a way for the Cambodian government to snap up a bunch of the land and squish the communities into a much smaller area than they've historically been using. So land tenure can go either way. It can either be a top tier, very tangible benefit, or it can be a junk benefit. And so that's the list that we usually look at. I hope this helps if you're actually buying carbon credits. Don't forget, it should really be as close as possible a one-to-one value from the resources that have been extracted to the amount of money that's being provided to the person who's losing the resource.